Thank you. So I thank the organizers for inviting me after this beautiful conference for the 60th birthday of Jean-Pierre. I think we met, maybe you don't remember that, in 88 or 89, because you won a prize by IBM. And I was there. The prize does not exist anymore, but we still exist. It's a very good point. So I am going to speak about hypercolor geometry. This has been started by in a Quebecus talk, but I recall the definition. So hypercolor is the same as what he called EIHS. So X is a hypercolor manifold. If and then, well, you can say X is a compact color, simply connected, and the space H20 of X is one-dimensional, generated by the class of two forms, which is everywhere non-degenerate. So this is the definition which is used by algebraic geometers. But in fact, the notion of a hypercolor manifold, it comes from a complex differential geometry. And the notion comes originally from the work of Yao. This is X, which is again a compact color, simply connected. And admitting Keller matrix of holonomy exactly SP of 2n. So 2n is a dimension X. So in fact, the history is that Yao had his fundamental existence result for Keller-Einstein matrix, and then Bovill used it to show that this manifold play a very important role in the classification of varieties with a trivial canonical bundles, as explained this morning by Quebecus. So what is very nice about this manifold is that we know everything about their deformation theory. So you introduce, so there is the Bovill-Bogomolov form. It's the main remarkable topological property of this X is the existence of this form. So it's Q, which is a quadratic form on H2 of X, Z, which looks like the intersection form on the H2 of a compact complex surface, for example, a K3 surface, which has a signature 3 B2 minus 3. With the properties that one characterization of this Q is that if you consider for any alpha in H2 of X, say Q, well, maybe here it's modulo torch. So you consider Q of alpha to the n. It is lambda x times the integral over x of alpha to the 2n. Okay. For some constant lambda x, which depends only on x. Okay. So it's, the existence of this Q is quite remarkable. But once you have it, yes, so what's the relation between the Q and the complex geometry? Is that you have the Hodge-Riemann relation, which apply, and we say that Q of sigma x is zero, and Q of sigma x bar is positive. And then you have the period map. So of course this is true, the Q it's only topological, the sigma x it depends on the complex structure on x, and that these relations they will remain true when you deform x, so the class of sigma x will deform also. So the period map, to define it globally, we use the marked moduli space, so you fix L, which is a lattice, and here it's a quadratic form, which is isomorphic as a lattice to H2 of X, Z, Q. Okay. And then the marked moduli space, basically it's a set of isomorphic classes of say hyperkähler complex structure on X, plus an isomorphism, the data of such isomorphism. This is why we call this marked. Okay, something like this. And then, so this is the analog of the Teichmuller space for curves. And the reason why we do this is that usually when you do deformation theory, you have a family of varieties XT, and then you cannot canonically identify the cohomology of the fibers because of monodromy phenomena. And that definition essentially kills the monodromy. And, okay. So when I say isomorphic classes, I should consider the action of diffeomorphisms of X on the space of this data and take the quotient. So totally this is what we're doing. Okay, and then on this marked moduli space, we have the period map, which takes value in D. So D is the period domain. So this is the subset of projective space of LC. LC is L tensor C, which is exactly defined by these equations here. So D is the set of eta such that Q of eta is zero, and Q of eta bar is positive. And what does the period map? So you have your complex structure XT, which is for example the deformation of the complex structure on X. You will associate to it the class of so you have the two zero form on XT, which is defined up to a coefficient that gives you a certain line. So that gives you a point in a PH2 of XT C. By definition of the marking, this is the same as P of LC, and the Hodge-Riemann relation here, that tells me that this point belongs to this D. So we have this, and if you know a little Hodge theory, it's very easy to show that this map is a local isomorphism, but there are two deep global results which govern this period map. They are due to Weibrecht and to Verbitsky. So the theorem is I actually two completely different theorems, but the two together they give you a complete picture of this period. So if X and X prime, so there are two hyperkähler manifolds, are birational, they are deformation equivalent. By deformation equivalent, it just means that one is a deformation of the other. The deformation theory, the local deformation theory, is excellent. There are quatrivial manifold, so the deformations are unobstructed. And more precisely, they are non-separated points in this marked moduli space. So, so the more precise version is that when you deform by a small deformation, arbitrarily small deformation of x and x prime, they become isomorphic. And the birational map that you get is a limit of this isomorphism. So, so there is this result. And the second result is that the period map P is induced, if you like, the isomorphism on each connected component of this marked moduli space, modulo the. So I should add here, in particular, these two points are identified by the period map. So modulo this non-separation phenomena. So, so in some sense, we know everything about these manifolds. But yes, the last thing that I wanted to say is that. Yes, there is something that I can add here concerning the properties of Q with respect to the complex structure. The H11 of X is the H20 of X plus H02 of X. The orthogonal complement of this space with respect to Q. And so, of course, here it's, the theory is entirely in the Keller setting. The problem is that, first of all, as you will see, to construct hyperkeller manifolds, essentially we need to be in algebraic geometry. The second point is that here I am speaking about these objects. Everything is totally transcendental. At the end, I will be happy to forget about the marking, but that is not possible in the compact Keller setting, because here to forget the marking, I will need to let the full automorphism group of this lattice act on this space. But the quotient is awful. It's exactly the same situation as if you consider complex tori, for example. There is absolutely no way of constructing a good moduli space of for complex tori. But in the algebraic geometry setting. Well, we just apply the Kodaira embedding theorem. For your X to be algebraic, you just need to have an ample line bundle. The class of an ample line bundle will be given by the class lambda in H2 of X, say Z, for example. You need this condition. And the manifold will be polarized by a lambda when the lambda is in H11. And by this condition, you just need that Q of sigma X lambda is zero. So you introduce a d lambda, which is a sort of a hyperplane section of d, defined by the condition that this is zero. And this d lambda now parametrizes marked algebraic varieties, which are also a hyperkeller. Which are polarized by the class lambda. And then out of this, you can construct true moduli spaces, because you can, this now is a Hermitian symmetric domain, and you can take the quotient by the automorphism group of the lattice preserving the class lambda. And the general Belli-Borel theory applies to give you a moduli space in algebraic geometry built as such a quotient. Okay, so but you see, what is nice is we really started from a complex differential geometry, and then finally we made these constructions which are totally transcendental. And at the end, we realized that we have an algebraic moduli space for the algebraic deformations of these branches. So now I want to present the viewpoint of algebraic geometry. Simply because for the construction problem, we know all the known examples are known via algebraic geometry. So the construction is. Of hyperkerners. So, of course, if S is a K-tree surface, then of course S is a hyperkerner, and we can get a K-tree surface by taking a degré 4 smooth surface in a P-tree. It's a trivial canonical bundle, so it is hyperkerner. But then there are constructions of associated moduli spaces, which are also hyperkerner. And the first one was constructed by Bovine. For any n, you can consider the Hilbert scheme. Which is a desingularization, it's a Crepin desingularization of the symmetric nth symmetric product. So it is known to be smooth by a result of Fogarty. It's a nice result, which is not true for a higher dimensional varieties. And Bovine shows that this is a hyperkerner. And then there are results by Mukai, more formal results, saying that moduli spaces of simple, well, in fact, if I want actually a moduli space, I put a stable shift on a K-tree surface. So they are hyperkerner, but only when they are projective. The problem is that most of the time, if you consider moduli spaces of stable objects, they are not projective. Because you need to put on the boundary, you need to add the semi-stable, not stable object. And the problem with this construction is that it has been proved later on by Yoshioka that in that case they are deformations equivalent to these manifolds. This is the problem with this result by Weybrecht. It shows that it is hard to produce new topological models because already all those which are birationally equivalent, they just give you the same kind of topological model. And this is what is happening here. And then, so for a long time, only this series of examples was known, plus similar series. Built starting from an abelian surface or a complex torus of dimension 2. About 15 years ago, O'Grady produced a new example. let me call it OG 10, because it is a 10 dimensional. It is called the O'Grady 10 dimensional exceptional hyperkeller manifold. How it is produced? So you consider S K3, and you consider the moduli space of semi-stable shifts, pure shifts, torsion-free shifts of rank 2, C1 equals 0 and C2 equals 4. So. So for this moduli space, you will have on the boundary semi-stable, not stable objects. Typically, you consider Z and Z prime as which are so this is a subscheme consisting of two points, and this is another subscheme consisting of two points. Then you consider the direct sum iZ plus iZ prime. This is this is exactly an object of that source, torsion free, C1 equals 0, C2 equals 4, but clearly it is semi-stable, not stable. So that produces singularities here, and what did O'Grady that he constructed? Crepant resolution. Which is this. Which is a hyperkeller manifold. And the way we know it is new, for a K3 surface, we know that the B2 of S is 22. For this hyperkeller manifold, the B2 is 23. And for the O'Grady example, the B2 number is 24. Okay, so why is this allusion to the Betti number is important? It's because by the result I described, this Torelli, in fact, the local Torelli theorem suffices. You see how many parameters you have for to deform an algebraic hyperkeller manifold, the polarized hyperkeller manifold. So you see that what you need is this d lambda. Now you start from your L, which has dimension 22. The projectivized space P of L, it has dimension B2 minus 1. Then you take a quadric inside, it is B2 minus 2. And then you take the hyperplane section lambda equals 0 to get your manifold polarized. So finally, if you want algebraic deformation of a hyperkeller manifold, the number of parameters is B2 minus 3. Okay. So what happens here is that for a K3 surface, we have many families with 19 parameters. So the corresponding manifold here, of course, you get also a 19 parameter family, but we expect 20 parameters. And the reason why we do not get all the deformation here is because in this construction, the varieties you get have a Picard number 2 and not 1, as it would be the case for a general algebraic deformation. And for the O'Grady, if you want algebraic deformations, you need 22 parameters. No, sorry, 21 parameters. Okay. So now comes something which I consider as surprising, because this description gives a feeling that it's really very hard to construct a new hyperkeller manifold. On the other hand, there is the following situation. So hyperkeller manifolds from cubic fourfolds. So you consider a smooth cubic fourfold. Okay, so it's defined by a homogeneous polynomial of degree 3. And well, of course, this is absolutely not a hyperkeller. It's a Fanon manifold of index 3. But it turns out that there are at least three associated families of hyperkeller manifolds. And furthermore, we get more than starting from K3 surfaces. The families have 20 parameters. Why 20 parameters? Because the moduli space of cubic four folds has a dimension 20. So what is the link between a cubic four fold and hyperkeller geometry? Is via the Hodge theory. So you consider the Hodge structure on H4 of X. Well, consider cohomology with integral coefficient. So that means that you consider the Hodge decomposition on H4 of XC, and it takes the form that H4 is the direction H31 plus H22. So there is no H40 because it's Fano, so there is no H40 form. Now the point is that this is one-dimensional, the H31 space. Finally, what you get up to a shift of by degree 1-1, it's a Hodge structure of hyperkeller tape. And what we get, in fact, is actually a variation of a Hodge structure of a hyperkeller tape, which is polarized by the intersection form on the analog of the Q, which was appearing here, is the intersection form on the middle degree cohomology. And furthermore, there is a polarization class, which is the class H square, which polarizes, which plays the role of the class lambda before. And that might seem formal, but what is really surprising is that we have this variation of Hodge structure, and out of it we can construct these three families. So I am going to list them here, or maybe the first two I will write here. The first one was discovered by Bovill and Donaghy. You consider F1 of X, which is the Fano variety of lines. So they are just a P1, lines contained in X. This is a hyperkeller four-fold, and it is a deformation equivalent. The second symmetric product of the second punctual Hilbert scheme of K3 surface. I should say more. Actually, there is a correspondence, incidence correspondence, a natural incidence correspondence, the family of P1s parameterized by this F1 of X, provides an isomorphism of Hodge structures between the H4 of the cubic and the H2 of the F1 of X. Similar phenomenon, but discovered much later, so is obtained by. It was done by Lehn, Zorger, and Van Straten. They started from the family of rational cubics. And this is a much rational cubic curve contained in X. This is much more difficult than here, because here you start from the objects are parameterized by the Grassmannian, and inside the Grassmannian there are a number of equations, so it's easy. But here you have to start with the Hilbert scheme of rational curves in P5, and it's not a very good object. And then they prove that basically it's a P2 bundle, well, it's birational to a P2 bundle over Z, which is a hyperkeller eightfold deformation equivalent to S4. And the last The last construction is the one I want to speak about. So I consider my x, which is a cubic four-fold. It is smooth, maybe I will take it general, but not very important. So consider consider a hyperplane section. Of x, a smooth hyperplane section. YH, so it's the intersection of X with the hyperplane H. So this is a cubic trifold, smooth cubic trifold, and associated to it there is a so-called Griffiths intermediate Jacobian. G of YH. Which is more than a complex torus. In fact, it's an abelian variety. But as a complex torus, it's defined as a... Well, it's a cubic trifold, so there is no H3-0 in the Hodge decomposition. And so the intermediate Jacobian just has this form. It's the quotient of the space H12 in the Hodge decomposition by the integral cohomology. So as a complex torus, it is presented like this, but we can say more. And the conclusion is that this object is it's a family of abelian varieties parametrized by the choice of the hyperplane section. And finally, we get the intermediate Jacobian fibration G over, which is a over U, which is so the U is the choice of H. So this is contained in the P5 dual of hyperplanes in P5. And this is the Zariski open set determined by the condition that Y has to be smooth. So let me denote it by YU. So these tori are five dimensional. And the base is five dimensional, so the total space is has dimension 10. And Donaghy and Markman, they had constructed non-degenerate, so everywhere non-degenerate, closed holomorphic two form. In fact, one can say more, can easily show that this closed holomorphic two form extend to any algebraic compactification of this intermediate Jacobian fibration. And our result with Lazar and Saka is that we constructed a compactification hyperkähler compactification of this intermediate Jacobian fibration, and not only it's a compactification as a fibration over U. So this is a Lagrangian fibration over U, and so there exists a hyperkähler compactification like this. It's also a flat map. And two, maybe let me call it this theorem A. And two, I need that X is a general. So for example, I think that the result does not work for if X contains a plane. And then this I is a deformation equivalent to these manifolds au gradi 10. So I'm going to explain not the point one, but a general method to this to prove the, such kind of a statement. So you see, there were several similar statements proved by, for example, Bovill and Donaghy, and then Lane, Zoghov and Stratton. So they, in their case, the fact that it was a deformation equivalent to S4 had been proved by Addington and Lane later on. And these proofs were based on a specialization argument so you consider special cubic four folds which are still smooth but so-called Fafian. So this method had been initiated by Bovill and Donaghy, and in their case it was quite easy to see that the specialization of the F1 of X was actually a Hilbert scheme of a certain associated K3 surface. But then in the other applications, this has become less and less easy to use. I mean, this specialization is not that good. So I want to show you a different argument for this part of the statement. So, and this, the method is by degeneration to a very singular cubic. But it turns out that the degeneration is not that bad from the viewpoint of the associated families of hyperkähler matrices. So. What we prove, so this is the part which is more recent, which is a joint work with Collard. So Collard, Lazza, Saka, and myself. So let X over delta be a projective morphism with fibers XT hyperkähler for T different from zero. Assume there exists a multiplicity one component of the central fiber X0, which is birational to M, which is a hyperkähler manifold. The fibers, the smooth fibers XT, are deformation equivalent. To this M. So the goal is to construct such a family with a central fiber, which has at least one component. So what is nice is that I may have a very bad singularities of the central fiber. I just know that one component is birational. It might be terribly singular, and this is what happens in the general situation. And in fact, this theorem B follows from a result which had been announced, in fact, by Todorov a long time ago, but I think he did not have a complete proof because the proof follows almost, it follows essentially from the Fyabinsky theorem. So the statement is as follows. So let now a family like this, again, it's a projective morphism. And I assume that X0, again, the fibers XT are hyperkähler. Now X0, there is no assumption on the multiplicity, but I know that it is not not uniruled. then the conclusion that is the following. The conclusion is that after performing a base change, I can modify my family into a family of smooth hyperkeler manifold. Okay. So then there exists, maybe after shrinking, the base change. A family x prime over delta prime. Now it's a family of smooth hyperkeler manifold. The morphism cannot be made projective. It's an important fact, but the fibers are projective. Furthermore, the x prime is birational. Okay. Over delta prime to the pulled-back family. Okay. So this is what I said. I have my family, original family. I make a base change, by birational transformation, I can make it into a family of smooth hyperkeler manifolds. So let me explain. I try to explain quickly. How this works. Doesn't matter. So that C implies B. I think it's almost clear because I start in the situation of B. As in theorem B. So I can, of course, apply the conclusion of theorem C because I have a component of the central fiber which is birational to something which is hyperkeler, so it's not uniruled. So I apply the theorem C and I get this smooth family here, which is birational over delta prime to the pullback family. Okay, so now here I choose a desingularization of this might be a very singular, and of course this is not a morphism. So again, here I have to blow up to make it into a true morphism. And this morphism now is of degree one. Now the point is that still here there exists a component of the central fiber. Okay, which is a birational to this M, which is a hyperkeler. Simply, this is the key point of this multiplicity one assumption. The original M, it remains as a component. It is not going to disappear by this transformation. And so I still have this component, and now it's a morphism of degree one, so there must be a component of this x prime tilde zero, which is a birational to this one. But the point is that this is a smooth, so the only non-uniruled component must be the x prime zero. And then the result is in fact an application of Weybridge, because xt is birational to x prime t, is just because by definition, so it is a deformation equivalent by Weybridge. This one is deformation equivalent to x prime zero, because it's part of the same family. This one is birational to M, so it is a deformation equivalent to M again by Weibrecht. And that's exactly what we want. Okay, and for the theorem C, I try to explain quickly how it works. So maybe I don't want to move this. So the key input of birational geometry is that under our assumptions, monodromy acting on H2 of the fibers XT is finite. So maybe I have no time to explain this, but that was really the key point provided to us by Collard. And then the monodromy is finite, so you can make a base change so that the monodromy is trivial. And when the monodromy is trivial, that means that the H2 of your fibers are canonically identified. And that means that the period map is defined. So we have this period map from delta star to the adequate period domain. It is polarized period domain because I'm working with the projective varieties. And then, it's a result due to Griffith, the period map extends. This is a hyperbolicity result. So these are Hermitian symmetric domains. So, holomorphic map from the punctured disk extends to holomorphically to a map like this. But then you consider your point P of zero, it's a point in the polarized period domain, and by surjectivity of the period map, it provides a certain hyperkeller manifold which has this period point. The local period map, the local deformation theory of a hyperkeller manifold, in particular of this one. So it says that the d lambda near this P of zero, it provides exactly the deformation of X prime zero. That means that my holomorphic disk in this period domain, I can see it as a family of deformations of my X prime zero. So I get this X prime over delta, maybe up to shrinking, with associated period map. Here. And then this is Ferbitsky. Ferbitsky Torelli theorem, which shows that the X prime is birationally. The fiber was birationally equivalent to the X delta prime. So I think I should stop here. Maybe yes, because I explained that I want to use a degeneration result combined with this argument in order to get this point too, that AORG is deformation equivalent to this O-graditen. So I just say in 1 minute, because the O-graditen, it is built from a K-tree surface. So I just want to show you how a K-tree surface can be obtained by degenerating a cubic fourfold. Yes. So in fact, we we are using so the the generation which had been invented by Hassett. So you consider W general cubic cubic, and we specialize to W0, which is a terribly singular, which is the discriminant cubic. P5 is the P5 of conics in P2. And inside there is the cubic, which is defined by the discriminant equation for this conics, and it is a singular. And it's also defined as a second variety of the Veronese surface. So you have P2. Okay, so from the viewpoint of the family of conics. This is here what you get are the double lines, so the most singular conics. Okay, and so it's a very singular. But what happens if you blow up a thing to a one parameter degeneration of to this W0? So this is obtained by considering a pencil. Okay, so that will give me a one parameter degeneration. But then the W infinite restricted, so this is another cubic, restricted to V. It's a restriction of a cubic, but my V, it's the P2, which is Veronese embedded. So this is a sextic curve in P2. When you have a sextic curve in P2, you usually take the ramified double cover of P2 ramified along this along C. And so our result is that under this generalization, the degeneration, we have our our family of a compactified intermediate Jacobian, and the IW0, the fact is that it is birational, or at least a component of it is birational to the moduli space, the Ugradi moduli space of this K3 surface. Okay. And this is then we can apply this theorem to conclude that this degeneration shows that these manifolds are deformation equivalent to the Ugradi manifolds.